Hey guys, welcome back to That Florida Feeling. Everybody doing okay? I hope you guys have had a great week. Adulting has got to me this week, but we've still got a really good episode. Thank you to everybody for your likes, comments, and interactions on the Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter pages. I think we all like the sun better than the water at the ocean. And apparently looking for seashells and people watching. Man, people watching on the beach is something else. Y'all know that. I wish I had as much confidence as some of those people I see. Woo! All right. Anyways, don't forget to turn on notifications and subscribe so that you don't miss any episodes. Also, guys, thank you so much to Natalie, I believe it was Natalie, for leaving a 5-star review on Apple. It was amazing. Thank you so much. That helped me so much. And the nice words were just made my day. But please don't forget to leave a 5-star review on Apple with a comment so more people can see how amazing this podcast is and love it like you guys do. Just want to say I hope everybody is okay from the hurricane that went through. I feel for all the people in Louisiana and even as far up as like Philadelphia and New Jersey. That thing was a beast and it got a lot of people. I hope everybody that's listening is safe. There's lots of ways to get help if you need it, guys. Just reach out. I'm just glad that, you know, for the most part, everybody was safe. It really was a monster storm. So just stay prepared. It's still peak hurricane season, I think, for 2 more months. Woo. And I know that, you know, stay prepared. And then it happens, you kind of lose your mind. You're like, ah! And I know it's horrible. But, you know, it's Florida. It's part of it, guys. So just be prepared. Be ready. Hope everybody's okay from that last one. All right, guys. I owed you an episode about breweries, and here it is. I was going to crack a beer open, but I don't have any right now. So just imagine cracking a beer. But we're going to talk about some awesome Florida breweries. I know that you guys were happy to share with me your favorites a couple weeks ago, and I really appreciate that. I hope you found some new ones since that, the questions and the episodes. I cannot wait to try the ones that were recommended to me. Still haven't gotten Total Wines. Hopefully my day off tomorrow I can get there. And let me know if you tried some new ones that we didn't even mention. I definitely want to, I'm always looking for something new for that. I am really, really sorry there was a delay in this episode, but here it is. So, crack a beer open, unless you're driving or at work. Both of those are frowned upon, don't do that. But enjoy this episode as we talk about craft beer scene that's just absolutely exploded here in Florida. So, a little bit of a backstory. Florida is home to 250 breweries that are located all over the state, and I do literally mean all over the state. The state's first brewery was actually the Florida Brewing Company in 1896, and the brewing industry was dominated mainly by mid-sized regional breweries up until about the 1950s. That's when we saw some microbreweries start to pop up, but really got popular 1980s, 1990s. They really got big here in Florida in the 80s. And of course, they could only grow so much due to laws, but after some legal changes in 2001, which we're going to talk about in a second, Florida has become home to more and more and more brew pubs, which are breweries and restaurants, and then just craft breweries on their own with their tap rooms. So, let's get an idea about those laws in Florida and about the breweries to understand the changes. Sorry guys, my cold is still with me, so forgive the stuffiness. All right, so brew pubs or restaurants are basically, they produce their own beer, but they produce limited amounts for sale on the premise. So that's a brew pub, or a brew pub, which is a restaurant with a brewery in it. The other type is a traditional brewery, which is just a brewery, and they have on-site tap rooms, and then they can distribute to off-site locations for sale. Now, the off-site sales are governed by a 3-tier system, which basically they sell to a distributor, the distributor sells it to retailers, and then the retailer sells it to the customer. So that's when you get it from, like, the gas station, Publix, really anywhere else that you would go to get Total Wines, things like that. That's where they get the distributor from it. But that also really opens them up to being able to sell in a lot more places. The Brewers Association defines several types of breweries, and all of them are present in Florida. There's craft breweries, which are independently owned and produce under 6 million barrels a year through traditional processes. Microbreweries, same traditional process, but they also produce under 15,000 barrels a year. So these are the more really, really locally known without distribution, not a lot of outside interference, like just at that one place kind of breweries. There's regional breweries which produce between 15,000 barrels and 6 million barrels a year, and they supply to like a fixed regional location. And then there's macrobreweries or megabreweries, and I'm sure we all think of one as soon as I say that, that produces over 6 million barrels a year, and that's going to be more like your Anheuser-Busch's. All right, now that we know what types of breweries we're talking about, let's talk about the kind in Florida. Like I said, all of those four do exist in Florida, and we are going to touch on them. Now, the earliest brewery in Florida was Tampa's Florida Brewing Company, and it was a regional brewery that was founded in 1896. The next regional brewery was Jack's Brewing Company in 1913, of course, in Jacksonville. And they were both repurposed during Prohibition and then went back to brewing after Prohibition had ended here in Florida. Now, Florida continued to see the growth and the opening of more regional breweries after Prohibition, so it kind of boomed for a little bit. But then, of course, Florida's regional breweries were competing with the national companies such as Anheuser-Busch's, and they all closed about the 1950s as national companies began to build their own locations in Florida, namely Joseph Schlitz Brewing Company, which would later become D.G. Yingling & Sons, built the brewery in Tampa that's still there today. And Anheuser-Busch built their brewery at Busch Gardens in Tampa in 1959. That one's since closed. But the one in Jacksonville for Anheuser-Busch is still open, and that was built in 1969. And that sort of pushed away the local brewers that had the local regions and weren't quite – they were big in their area, but they weren't quite as big enough to go to other areas. Now, the beer scene really started to turn into brew pubs with the microbrewery boom in the 1880s and 90s. Gosh, a lot of this is set to say. All right, sorry. I'm trying not to stumble over my words, but it's like all the bees. Okay, so the breweries were restricted from growing at first due to state laws that banned non-standard container sizes that most of the craft breweries actually used at the time. So, of course, it wasn't like the standard 20-ounce bottle. It was something else, and that's really kind of what squashed their growth. But a law was passed in 2001 that reduced the restrictions, and then starting in 2005, the state really began to see growth in the amount of breweries and brew pubs due to this law passed a couple years earlier that reduced these restrictions and allowed more use of other containers, the restricted sizes that aren't restricted anymore, and it really allowed people to try to do their own thing. Now, the state of Florida produced 1,207,936 barrels of beer in 2016 alone, so I'm sure that number is way more 5 years later. Florida has 250 breweries all over the state. Now, of course, that does not include those home brewers, kind of like you, Chad. Shout out to you. Hope you're okay from the hurricane. Of course, that does also include the larger breweries such as the Yingling one that we talked about. And unfortunately, some have closed since then due to the pandemic. A few of Florida's breweries are owned by larger companies such as like Big River Grill and Brewing Works. That's a long name. So Big River Grill and Brewing Works and Ragtime Seafood and Tavern, and they're both owned by Craftwork restaurants and breweries. So that's more of a like a chain type thing. Like, and I want to say the Big River Grill is in Disney Springs or around it. So that's more considered a chain, a kind of a chain thing more than just a local brewery. So we're going to talk about craft beer, and most craft beers, of course, are smaller, and being a brewery that produces a small amount of beer a year. Wow, guys. And that's usually independently owned because it is such smaller, but these breweries have a lot more creativity to them. They usually have an emphasis on the enthusiasm for beer, the new flavors, and the different types of brewing techniques that we see a lot of today, especially with the bourbon barrels and things like that really do add a new flavor and a new level of beer to the scene. Now, craft brewing or microbrewing really started in the 1960s in the U.S., and they really had the idea that in order to succeed, you had to make more than great beer. You had to be about the customer. You had to listen to what they wanted. You had to try new things. You had to try to not be so afraid to do new things, because they really needed to set themselves apart from the larger companies like the Busch's and the Yinglings and the Budweisers and things like that. Now, of course, recent changes made by the Brewers Association have also allowed larger breweries to be classified as craft beer, such as like your Sam Adams, your Dogfish, even Yingling, and Founders, which are more well-known all over the U.S., more so than outside of just one local area. And that's really what you also can think of when you think of craft beer, but it's more of the more nationally known craft beers. Although Florida does have a couple of well-known craft breweries that have gained a huge following outside of Florida, such as Cigar City and Funky Buddha. Florida does have more hotspots for breweries with larger groupings in places like Tampa, Jacksonville, and basically from West Palm down to Miami. And the problem with that is that it's great that all these people love beer, but these groupings in these places kind of make it harder for breweries to stand out. But also by grouping together, they create a place for people to go who love the beer scene, the festivals that go along with it. And it really just allows people to kind of create a community with the idea that there's a common theme. So it's a good and a bad. I mean, I love going to Tampa because there's so many breweries. You can just brew, you can just hop from one to one to one. And you get to try all these great things, and not a lot of them are similar at all. And then you get to compare, and then you forgot what you tried, and you got to go back and try it again. But that really does create its whole other kind of like a beer vacation or a, you know, something like that, that really has opened a whole new level of almost tourism within itself here in Florida by just having all these groupings in one. So, let's talk about these breweries. And we're going to talk about one of the top breweries in Florida first. And I love this one. We're going to talk about Cigar City. And Cigar City was mentioned by you guys quite a bit. It was founded in Tampa in 2007, and it's actually been producing beer since 2009. Joey Redner, who is a Tampa native, founded the brewery after working with Wayne Wambles as his brewmaster, and they produced the first batch of Cigar City beer. Do you know what the first batch was? I was shocked, and it's not Hyla, if you're thinking that. It's actually Maduro Brown Ale, and it was produced on January 30th, 2009. I love the Maduro, but I feel it's an often overlooked beer. I just didn't realize that was their first, so that's actually really cool. Now, of course, they would eventually add Hyla and Florida Crackers Belgian-style white ale. And this first beer was produced in the brewery on Spruce Street, which is still their home to their brew house, but of course there's also a packaging hall and a tasting room there now. And the company produces about 170,000 barrels annually, and they distribute to 39 states. So to say that they're a craft brewery who stayed small is an understatement. They have grown and grown, and I could even find it in Tennessee, and that's what I always liked. When I was away from Florida, I could still find my favorite beer from Florida. Now, of course, the company is most well-known for the Hyla, but since 2010, they have released, and I'm going to pronounce this wrong, Hunapus Imperial Stout every March that comes with a beer festival to celebrate its release. And the release is actually usually attended by over 5,000 fans and other breweries all over the world just to join in for this beer festival. And you can't buy this stout. It's literally only gotten if you go and attend the festival. Now, of course, they did have a release in 2021, but of course, due to COVID, it was pre-release that you had to pick up. But it's cool that they still continued that tradition. Now, Cigar City has continued to grow, and it's even partnered with Oscar Blues Brewery to form Canarchy Craft Brewery Collective. So it includes the Oscar Blues, Cigar City, Perrin Brewing, and Utah Brewers Cooperative. So that's really cool that they have grown from a small craft beer out of Tampa to be able to be in a collective to really help get the product out there. And not only the product, but just the love of craft beer. Now, Cigar City has 8 year-round beers that include Hyla, Maduro, Florida Cracker, Guayabera, Hyla, Fancy Papers, Margarita Ghost, and Frost Proof. Now, they also have seasonal selections, which have included Maduro Nitro, Fair Exchange, and White Oak Hyla. I loved White Oak Hyla. That is probably one of my favorites. And, of course, they've also done special releases that include Lager, Tokabaga, and You Should Smile More, that actually came from the Pink Boots Society working with Cigar City to create a hop-forward tribute to women who work in the industry, which is cool on its own. Of course, they do have other offers, and you can even join their barrel-aged beer club called El Catador. And so that's kind of for people who really do want the craft beer that's gone one step further, that's been aged in barrels that have had, you know, whiskey or bourbon in them. And it really does give the beer a whole nother taste. The club was created to foster a community of craft beer lovers that appreciates new and different beers. And you can sign up for the club if you go to their website. I'm not into stuff like that. I have tried it. But it's just not for me. I'm just a little IPA person. But if that's down your alley, definitely look it up on their website. Cigar City does have a taproom and a brewery on Spruce Street, the same place they opened. And of course, that's right off North Del Mabry in Tampa. You can visit it 7 days a week. They have 24 beers on tap for you to try while you're there. You can try one beer, a whole flight, get your growler filled, buy merch, or even take that six pack home. Whatever you want to do to show your love for this brewery. And of course, Cigar City is available in your grocery stores and convenience stores, especially if you're a high life fix. And of course, you can visit their website to see what they have that's new, what's coming up, what's going away, where to find them, and pick up that merch if you can't make it to that tap room on Spruce Street. They've even gone as far as to be able to open a brew pub and a tap room in the Tampa International Airport, so if you're flying in or out, definitely get a pint before you hop on your plane or leave the airport to come into the city. And they have a tap room and Animally Arena to help you cheer on the Bolts to their next win. So to say that Cigar City has come far from its first batch in 2009 is almost an understatement. It's really cool to see what they've done, where they're going, and where they're going to go. So I, for one, am looking forward to see what they come up with next, and I can't wait to get back up to that tap room. All right, the next brewery is one that's not well known, but it's getting well known, or it's getting there. It does have kind of a following in the Tampa Dunedin area. And of course, it's one that I love and I wish that was in more of the state so I could find it everywhere. And that's Seventh Son Brewery in Dunedin, Florida. The brewery was actually opened in 2012 by Devin Krebs. And Devin holds a degree in fermentation science and even worked for Anheuser-Busch. Went on to work in a small brewery in Georgia before learning the skills and deciding that she could do just as good. So it's really cool because it is a woman-owned brewery. And if you ever go there, you can catch a glimpse of her. And she teamed with two other friends and opened the brewery in 2012. Now, the brewery started out really small. It started out in a 600-foot storefront, expanded in late 2013. The current brewery in Dunedin is now 1,200 square feet with 10 taps in their tasting room and a lot of outdoor seating. And I think the reason that I love this brewery is because, their beer is really good. Two, they have some really, really cool creations that you can try. And three, because it really does give you that Florida feeling. You get to go get a beer and you get to sit out and you get to watch the traffic go by, or you get to sit underneath this really cool little seating area right outside on their parking lot, and it's covered. And so if it rains, who cares? If it's blazing hot, you're covered, there's fans going, and it just lets you relax and take in that Florida feeling. So I really do love this one. They do have a majority of lagers and saisons that are produced in the Dunedin Brewery. Now, of course, they started off with small batches due to the small space, but they have since grown. But those small batches did allow them to try some new and fun flavors. The location in Dunedin is actually close to the downtown area and the marina, so you can really walk to and from it, especially with all the free parking in the area. It's not far from anything in Dunedin, so it's kind of nice. And it really allows them to be a mainstay in that Florida town. Now, the brewery has actually expanded to Tampa. They did just open a Tampa facility in Seminole Heights in August of 2017. The larger facility also allows them to push the limits with more flavors and brewing, and they actually get to try their barrel-aged beers there as well now. The location in Tampa has 28 taps and is a larger tasting room, and they actually feature great artwork from locals that's always on display, so they're still kind of giving back to the community. The location in Tampa also has a huge canning system to allow for more production. So maybe one day I'll get them in the rest of the state. And you can visit either location to try their great line of beers. They have a large selection of IPAs, Berliner Weiss, Ghost, Stouts, and Porters. And they have some really, really cool names for their beers. Not one to shy away from their names. They have Headbanger, which is one of the most popular in their line. And then they have other fun names, which is Kitty Likes Milk, which is my favorite. It's a chocolate stout. If you ever find it on tap, at least try it. It's so good. But then the other fun names, If It Puts the Cucumber on the Skin or It Gets the Ghost Again, which is the ghost, Graffiti Orange, which is another hugely popular great one. They have Call Me the Breeze, which is a sour, Partners in Crime, which is Farmhouse Saison. I'm probably not saying that right, sorry guys. And then Project Popsicle, which is an American IPA, and Slaughter of the Soul, which is an Imperial Stout. So half the fun is just going in there and ordering these fun named beers and trying them all. They do keep 13 brews a year around, which does include an IPA, a hard cider, a stout, a Weiss, a porter, and a saison. And their breweries and their tap rooms just really are a fun place to take in the local area. You can also buy some merch. You can get your growler filled. They have six packs for sale. It's just a really fun place to go. The outdoor seating, like I said, is amazing. It's right off the road. You can watch the traffic go by. You can take in the town. The Tampa Brewery lets you get a really good look at the area with the just how creative Tampa can be. And it really does have something for everybody. It's a place you want to check out if you're looking for something different, if you have just want somewhere to go and sit for a little while and sip on a beer, if the weird is for you. Or if it's just something new to try, definitely walk into any brewery if you like beer. Or even if you're not sure if you like beer, just go give it a try. You might find something new. The next place I'm going to talk about is another pretty well-known one in Florida and a little, actually outside of Florida too. And that's the Funky Buddha Brewery. It's in Oakland Park. And the brewery actually started as a brew house, hookah lounge, and music venue in Boca Raton in 2006. The couple who bought it were Ryan and Gianna. Since, and seeing the popularity of the beers, they decided that they wanted to shake it up a little bit and get more into the market, and that was about 2010. So they moved locations and even started brewing beer in their home. So if you're a home brewer now, just wait, you know, there's hope for you. Maybe one day you'll own your own brewery. Just don't give up on your dreams. Now, the new location is also in Boca Raton, so they didn't go far, and it was officially named Funky Buddha Lounge and Brewery. Of course, Funky Buddha made their most well-known and popular drink in 2011 with the creation of the Maple Bacon Coffee Porter. That just sounds amazing. And of course, the brewery started using the Cigar City Brewing System in 2012 to officially brew and bottle their beer to start distribution of their product. The pair continued success with their brand and opened a homebrew supply store at their location. So it's kind of another business within a business at their lounge and brew house in 2012 so that people could try and invent their own beers. And that's really cool that they're encouraging others, not just to, you know, hey, buy my beer, but also try your own. You never know what you're going to invent. And of course, the success for Funky Buddha was said to have paved the way for others to create what is now a thriving local brew system in that area. So that's cool. Not only do they kind of get that area going, but they've also encouraged others to join them. So that's really great. And of course, the company saw a lot of success and continued to grow in 2013 with Casey Sent, which is Ryan's brother, opening a second location and a production facility in Oakland Park. The location in Oakland included a 3,000 square foot tap room with 30 draft lines to be able to serve many new and different creations. And it is a large tap room. It is a really nice one. And each year since 2013, they release a limited edition Sison to commemorate each team that no longer has an undefeated season to remember the year the Miami Dolphins had an undefeated season in 1972, and that remains unmatched. 2014 brought so much growth for Funky Buddha that it was available in over 400 restaurants in South Florida, and it continued to grow, even getting a celebrity cruise that announced a celebrity cruises announcing a four-day Funky Buddha craft beer cruise in 2015. And that actually helped bring the distribution to Northern Florida. Now, the brand was eventually brought out by Constellation Brands in 2017, but the Sense brothers stayed on to run the day-to-day operations to keep that idea of Funky Buddha alive. And, of course, the goal of Funky Buddha was to have different and funky flavors that can be seen in their selections even today. So the Maple Bacon Coffee Porter Day, they released the Maple Bacon Coffee, and it's a street festival where guests can come and pick up a brew. It's only made once a year. But, of course, when they're there at the festival, they encourage them to try new and different flavors of the brand. And, of course, due to COVID, Funky Buddha is not available for tour, but they offer a virtual tour, which is really, really cool. So you can still kind of see the goings-on in the day-to-day operations and get an idea. And hopefully maybe one day they'll open up to their guests again. You can still visit their tap room in Overland Park. Now, of course, they have their year-round favorites, such as Pineapple Beach, Forget About It, and Hop Gun IPA. Side note, Pineapple Beach is my favorite. I love it. So if you haven't tried it, definitely go pick up a bottle. You can also get their limited releases and guest drafts while in the tap room that allow you to try something different and keeping your favorites available all the time. And their tap room is really cool because they also have a restaurant with it, so it's kind of that brew pub thing, and they have food to enjoy with your favorite beers. You can also get your favorite beers to go in cans or bottles to take it on for your later enjoyment. Just don't drink and drive. Funky Buddha is available in most grocery stores, and actually a lot of taps at your local bars. I usually get the pineapple one when I go out because it's just like a clean, fun beer. It feels summery. It feels like Florida all the time. I love it. And you can usually find it on tap. And if you're a huge Funky Buddha fan, don't forget to check out that merch shop on their website so that you can see how much. I mean, they really do have like a really good selection of merch, so you can kind of see, you know, how just the name Funky Buddha really does relate to everything that they do. They really were a trailblazing brewery, and they really did get the ability to go and do what they wanted and making it as interesting as possible. So I definitely think Funky Buddha is one of those really cool breweries that, you know, it's great that they do call Florida home. It's one that's, it really did kind of set the bar for a lot of the Florida breweries in that area, because of how different they were. I mean, the maple bacon porter alone is just, that's awesome. So yeah, give them, if you ever see them on tap, try it. Pick up a bottle, a single. Definitely recommend checking out that brewery or trying that beer. The next brewery is one that I love, 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 but it's more of a microbrewery. I wish it was in more parts of Florida, but unfortunately it's only in two parts of Florida, and that's McGuire's. Now, if you're hearing of McGuire's, if you're hearing me say McGuire's and you know what it is, you're probably thinking brewery. And then the rest of you are probably thinking, what is McGuire's? So McGuire's is actually an Irish pub. They have two locations in Destin and Pensacola. So it's up in the Panhandle. And it's a legend. McGuire's is an absolute legend. It is amazing. They have some of the best Irish food and drinks in the area. But they also make their own beer. A lot of people, I guess, don't realize that. And that's all they serve in their restaurants. They literally make their beers in their restaurants. They have a brewery. The one in Destin, it's located kind of beside the restaurant, main restaurant where you eat near the gift shop. Because, of course, they have a gift shop. But it's just a great place. It really is family friendly, even with the brewery. So the Irish Pub was actually opened in 1977. It started out in Pensacola in a small shopping center. And of course, it's since moved to a larger location than it is right now. And it was in the original 1927 old firehouse, which is the Pensacola McGuire's that you see today. And they eventually opened an equally busy and amazing location in Destin in 1996. And that's right off 98, right across from the Harbor Walk. That's the one that I usually visited, and I loved it. I wish I could go back for their bean soup and their sandwiches and just amazing. And they have good burgers, an Irish pub that has great burgers. All right, sorry. We'll talk about restaurants in another episode, I promise. But the pub is also known for its signed dollar bills that literally line every square inch of the pub. So, we've talked about the restaurant, and if you're still wondering why, it's because this brewery is amazing. They have some amazing beers. And a lot of people really didn't realize that it was a brewery as well. They just think it's a restaurant. So, McGuire's Craft Beer technically opened in 1988, and they're all brewed on premises, both locations. They offer ales, porters, and stouts, and they use a traditional oak and copper brewery. They believe that the use of nature and knowledge, along with an amazing master brewer, has helped create these selections. They also use their own house yeast in their products to give it that special McGuire's touch. They have five regular beers on tap and rotating specials. The regular lineup includes McGuire's Light Ale, Irish Red Ale, IPA, Porter, and Irish Stout. And of course, they rotate selections depending on the seasons, with specials usually around Christmas and Oktoberfest. For you non-alcoholics or kids, they also make a popular root beer that's served right out of a keg, so you can still feel the brewery effect even in the root beer. You can visit their brewery for a tour and enjoy their food at either of these great locations. Their brewmasters are happy to talk to you. And since they do have a gift shop, they sell their beers so that you can take home with you. You can buy a six pack. I understand why they don't sell them outside the stores, because it is a microbrewery, but I wish that they did sell it, since I live so far away from them now. So if you're ever up in the Panhandle, Destin or Pensacola, or if you're nearby in Fort Walton, drive over to Destin or Pensacola and just check them out. They have great food. You won't be disappointed. The beer, though, I think is just, for being a microbrewery, it is really good. So I just wanted to add that brewery in there. It's just something a little different. Plus, it's one of the we talked about. Definitely check them out, though, if you have the time. So we talked about a lot of places in Florida that seem like that they make sense for craft beer. But what about Jacksonville? Do you think of Jacksonville when you think of craft beer? Maybe like Jack's Beach. Because they actually have a really big craft beer scene. My favorite up in Jacksonville, though, is Intuition Ale Works. The brewery was actually founded by Ben Davis in 2010. He founded Intuition Ale Works as a way to be involved in his hometown and to give back to his community. He opened it, and it's since been one of the fastest growing breweries in the area. They also made history by being the first craft beer in the state of Florida to put its beer in cans. You can still take a tour of this brewery and see how history is made when this brewery runs. They do have a taproom and a restaurant in Jacksonville on East Bay Street with 18 taps. They have their favorites, and they have their rotations and specials. You can find IPAs, Goose, Golden Ales, Pilsners, Lagers, and Stouts on their tap list. They also have brews to go in cans, bottles, and cases. Their most popular beer, though, of course, is the Eitzen IPA, which is personally my favorite. I think it's one of the better IPAs out there for craft in Florida. And you can find it in most grocery stores and bars. Okay, let me take that back. You can find it in most grocery stores and bars in northern and central Florida. Unfortunately, they haven't made it to South Florida yet. So if you're in Jacksonville, definitely check this brewery out. I don't think you'll be disappointed. The food at the restaurant is also amazing. If you're an IPA fan and you can't make it, just see if you can find one in Publix or Total Wines or ABC and just check out a single. I definitely recommend their I-10 IPA, though. It's probably one of my favorites. So the last brewery I'm going to talk about is Sailfish Brewery in Fort Pierce. Sailfish started out when three friends tried to homebrew and actually found it successful. They began to go to festivals and continued to get the recipe just right, and then they created the Sailfish Brewery and Brew Pub. Sailfish has opened a newer location in 2017 where they can serve their brews and create new ones. They were able to expand in 2019 and partner with the distribution center to actually get their beers into more of the Florida markets. They prefer to use local Florida ingredients when possible to create that perfect Florida beer. Now, you can find Sailfish in most parts of Florida. I did the little website, and you actually can find it up in the panhandle at a bar. I was surprised, but you can. And you can find it in most grocery stores and restaurants. You can visit their beautiful tap room that's located in Fort Pierce that includes a pizza kitchen, because pizza and beer go together. Actually, they really do. That's probably one of my favorite combinations. Get a big old slice of cheese pizza and like an IPA. That's a good day. And you can actually find 22 different brews on tap that include seltzer, cider, stouts, milk stouts, which include milk and imperial, sours, ales, IPAs, and lagers. The brand has some amazing brews that include Howchata IPA, and I think the interesting one is the Thai Iced Tea Golden Ale. So they not only do they have really good combinations, they have really good names too, which I think is part of craft beer. If you're going to make something different, you got to name it something good. And they're a really good Florida brewery success because they're still continuing to grow and to add to the craft beer scene. And it's definitely in their own little area since it's a little more north of Miami. So I think they're making their own stamp in their area. Now, I know that we've all got our favorite breweries, and things have been really rough for a lot of us for the past almost 2 years at this point. So if your brewery isn't open, see if you can just go buy it. Like, even if the tap room isn't like open for pints, see if you can just go purchase it there and take it home. Purchase them in store, buy their merch, show them love, because we all need to make it through these tough times. They've probably gotten you through some tough times as well, so it's time to give back to them. Now, I know I haven't talked about all of them because, like we said, there's 250 breweries in Florida, so we all know what's coming next. There's going to be a part two. I know I didn't mention some of the ones, like you guys said, Due South, another amazing one in Boynton, Tampa Bay Brewing Company, love the Ybor City tap room, that is just an amazing place, Swamp Head, still excited to check that one out, and Creaky Can, so those are probably going to be my part two. And if you think of another one that you didn't love, message me about it, I can add it to my part two. I always love it when you guys have suggestions. Plus, that helps get the other business out and people, like, find new things. And that's really the point of this, that Florida feeling, is to find new places and new things to explore and new things to try. And it's just showing our love for this sunshine state. Actually, you know what, guys? If there's 250 breweries, we might even have a part three. Let's see how we can do this. But just remember, guys, please drink responsibly. Don't drink and drive. And for the love of God, don't turn into Florida man. The Florida Man story today comes to us from 2020, and the headline is basically the whole story. The Florida man arrested on allegations that he used a COVID relief fund to buy a Lamborghini and bankroll the rest of it. He sounds like a wonderful human being. Yeah, I think I remember that happening. Anyways, guys, don't be that person. Be nice to others. Don't do that. But thank you guys for listening. I hope you found a new brewery that you like. I'm sorry that this is one of my shorter episodes, adulting and such. Thanks for the answers on the Instagram and Facebook post. I hope that you guys look forward to the next question, because you guys' questions also help me to think of new episodes. So if you have a suggestion or want to hear something in particular or comment, anything like that, you can feel free to message me on Facebook or Instagram. Or you can even email me at thatfloridafeel@gmail.com. Thank you again, Natalie, for that 5-star review. You are amazing. All right, guys. I hope everybody has an amazing week. Have a good weekend. Stay safe, stay hydrated, stay prepared. Be nice, use sunscreen, don't turn into Florida man for whatever you do, don't do that. And as always, that's your daily dose of sunshine.